you're going to require one. I think teachers having skin in the game, it's expensive for us to live here. I mean, it's expensive. I mean, the economy is bad, but teachers, if you, you know, back in the day, when teachers lived in the community and worked in the community school, you had that sense of community. But, I mean, you kind of look across the board. If all of us are required to, I mean, as a trustee, I'm required to live here, but you're not going to require a teacher or the other folks to live, but as a top person, a superintendent, I get, yes, they need to live in Dallas. But then when you start going down, I mean, so you're saying by being an executive level, you don't have skin in the game because you live somewhere else, but teachers who live or counselors who live somewhere else, they have skin in the game?
They don't vote in this district.
But they work, and we give them a check every month. I'm just saying, I can see where you requiring one but not requiring the other to live in the district.
Okay. Do we have any alternate language?
Mine is not alternate language. It is leave the policy as it is. It is good policy. It has worked for us. Boards before us and certainly some bad acting boards before us have not tampered with this policy. We need to leave it as it is. Those people in those positions should be vested in this district, and they make the decisions and carry out and help with the implementation and facilitation for 20,000 employees. This policy is good policy, and we need to keep it as it is.
Trustee Baratheon, so this will be my last comment.
Yeah.
We need to realize the times that we're in, not only economically, but us as a school district. We're looking for a new superintendent. We're also looking for a chief of staff, chief of HR, chief of schools, chief of a lot of things. To me, this is about attracting the top talent, regardless of zip code, regardless of race, regardless of ethnicity, regardless of gender. This addresses top talent regardless of anything. And I'll walk you through a hypothetical example. Let's say you get an HR executive from JCPenney's in Plano that wants to come to DISD and help us figure out our HR department. Let's say this person, and this is completely hypothetical, I don't know anybody in JCPenney's. Let's say the spouse works in Richardson. Let's say this person has three kids, 8, 12, and 16. But this HR executive wants to come help DISD with one of our most critical areas, and that's human resources. Are we really going to say, you know, we think you're the best person for this job, but we're going to require you and your family to move 30 minutes south? That doesn't matter to me if somebody drives 45 minutes to work every day. You're either motivated. Two types of motivation, intrinsic, extrinsic, motivated by pay and what that lifestyle can bring you, and you're motivated by how you do your job, the pride and the professionalism that you bring to work every day. That's it. If I was a chief or a potential chief looking at a very high-paying executive job, I would question the district's motivation in hiring me if they required me to live in Dallas. Because I would ask, you're more important than where I live, than the qualifications I bring to your organization. That's it. I want the best chiefs that are willing to help out DISD. Doesn't matter to me where you live. That's it.
I was happy with the language all the way through, because if we get a candidate for a superintendent, part of his contract, it says, look, I've got this great house, it's 10 minutes right outside of Dallas ISD, and if we really wanted him, I guarantee you, probably a majority of us would waive the policy. We can waive the policy. Let me say what I want to say. We can waive the policy anytime we want. But we're trying to get top talent. We often say, and I can't see the distinction either, when we say, well, these have to live here, these don't. Because one of the mantras that we hear is that who's the most important, the most important classroom teachers and principals.
You don't treat us that way, though.
And yet, they do, there's no requirement for these folks to live in Dallas ISD. We get the best people possible. And I think that's what we should be aiming at, is the best people possible. Not the best people who happen to live within this limit that we've got for Dallas ISD. And if it means going 10 minutes outside and robbing the suburbs of their top talent, I say, let's do some blind. They've been doing it to us for years.
Amen, sister.
We do all sorts of training and experience, and we have folks stolen from Dallas ISD left and right. Everybody who's sitting around this horseshoe knows that. So I think maybe the time for us to start doing a little taken from the suburbs is there. So for me, I don't care where anybody lives other than the trustees, because this is an elected position. It is an elected position, whereas the superintendent, the executive directors, they are not elected. They are hired here, and usually they're hired on a one-year contract, if any, or they are at will. So when we start talking about a house in this particular economy, you're going to lose lots of money if you have to sell your house. Also, the other thing that I really think about a lot is by the time somebody gets up in their career to the point where they would qualify as an executive director, they generally have children who are at the high school age. Most people who have children at a high school age, they will opt to keep their kids in the school district so that they can grab. This is where they've made their friends. This is where they're in the band. They're in the drill team. They're in different organizations, and they've been all through their school career. And parents don't want to uproot their children. So I think we sacrifice a huge talent pool. And for me, this is because we've always done it this way. And I do resent the insinuation that only bad trustees change policies. I heard that. And I'm sorry that another trustee would think that.
I just need to know the difference between executive director and director. What is executive director and what is a director?
The bosses of the
Okay, so there's a deputy director and a director.
Fit the old policies. I think there's something like 40.
40 old.
So you have the superintendent, chiefs, executive directors, and directors.
Okay, cut the level out of it. What's the difference?
Can I assume, or at least ask the trustees permission here? We're going to basically say all the same things here in 2 weeks on this policy when it comes up for a vote. So can we move on? These meetings cost us several thousand dollars an hour. So we're going to have this conversation, and then we're going to have the identical conversation in 2 weeks, and we're not making any more changes to the song.
Unless somebody's willing to offer some alternative language. I said that two times already.
For the revenue requirement?
This policy, offer alternative language. Otherwise, this is what's going to show up in 2 weeks.
Well, we can vote on minutes at the board meeting as well. Why don't we send out?
We could propose amendments right now. I mean, if people don't.
This way. All right, thank you. I just want to say again, the board briefing is the time for us to oftentimes things are repeated and said again or addressed again at the board meeting because we keep things as they are, and one may wish to do that, but nobody should be stifled from saying what he needs to say about a policy or any one of the items. As far as bad trustees, what I was saying about that is boards have been described as being bad boards before, slam dunk, et cetera, et cetera. That's what I was referring to, the description and characteristics of boards who never address this policy. So I'm not trying to characterize any boards myself. And I just want to say that I want this policy pulled. I'm requesting that the policy be pulled. I appreciate so much what Trustee Parrott said about investing in this community. And just to reiterate, this is a public institution. We pay very well. We've had people from out of town before. For example, we're talking about high positions, HR, and we were told in 2008 that our HR department was in the worst shape it had ever been, and that person did not live in the city. Anyone who applies for a position in Dallas ISD will know what our requirements are, what our policies are, or they should ask. And I believe with the unemployment rate out there with some excellent talent that we have an excellent opportunity to get good people who will come here to serve us well, but will be invested in this community as public officials.
So you're looking for language?
Let me take a stab at it.
Okay.
On page one, superintendent schools should be a qualified resident in the period.
Yes.
Right there, everybody goes out to that.
Yes.
Sixth paragraph where everything should be taken out. Okay, where it says all district employees that were taken out, all district employees that report directly to the superintendent should be qualified residents. If we have a deputy, chief, whatever you call that, those that report directly. Next in line is what I'm talking about.
So
you're rewriting this.
I'm rewriting it. I have to ask you guys several times.
Chiefs and the superintendent.
Right. That's it.
That's what they're called now.
That's why I'm just trying to figure out names. What are they going to be when we get a new
chief? Reports to the superintendent shall be barred by residents of the district.
I would still be opposed to it because you could just expand your list. You're saying, okay, it's four or five now. Well, somebody coming in might have 40. All right, I'm
going to
have all 40 of these people.
No, we're not going to have 40. We're not going
to
have 40.
That would be up to the superintendent.
Well, it would be up to the superintendent. There you go. You got 40 people.
Yeah, I have a problem.
And Chief Miller, I don't believe, lives within DISD, even though he worked for the city of Dallas for decades. Is that right? I don't mean to call you out, Chief.
The Dallas Police Department changed their rules and regulations years ago. All the chiefs on the Dallas Police Department had to live within the city. Probably 15 years ago that changed, and the only chief that has to live in the city of Dallas is the chief of police, David Brown.
And that's like with the fire department.
So with
yes,
the amendment,
correct.
With the amendment that you just proposed, Chief Miller, you'd have to move. Is that your honest
officer?
The next paragraph, the board encourages all employees to reside, blah, 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 the superintendent should encourage to become residents and so forth. I'm okay with that. The next, as far as compliance, I think the waiver language should stay there. The board, upon recommendation of the superintendent of schools, may approve waivers of this policy. That would allow a person to complain or a person to still come in. It's just a matter of the superintendent saying, will you waive this policy in this case? And we've done that before, and I think we can do it again.
Are you talking about a one-time waiver for their time for a year, or are you talking about a yearly waiver? That's what we were doing in the past.
Once we give them the waiver, it's
there.
It
was a waiver, that's what I think Jim
was on
the waiver.
As long as they continue to work for us,
it's a lifetime waiver.
This is the policy is
no,
today
no,
requires me more tangible.
I think that once you've got it, you've got it.
It's future of the future board.
It changes.
But then the future board has to come in and change the policy.
Right.
But this policy, this board is saying, wait. Okay? We can work that in such a way that the board wants to come in, the next board come in and say, we want to change it, and so-and-so has to move in. That board has to make that decision.
So President Blackburn, your reason for saying direct reports are to clarify why you feel that direct reports should live in the district.
I'm trying to be in the middle. We're talking about people who say we should have everybody.
I mean, my position,
but
once again,
saying, is... You're talking about someone having skin to teeth. Our superintendent having skin, just like the board having skin. The direct reports right below the superintendent having skin. Everybody below that.
So you're telling me that the chief should teach my daughter versus the teacher teach my daughter? I mean, the skin in the game is skin in the game. You either care to make the difference or you don't.
Oh, okay.
It's all the error.
Okay.
Remember,
three times I asked, give me alternative language.
My alternative language. Superintendent of schools shall be a bona fide resident of the district. Take the rest of out, period. Take all the other stuff out. Keep bona fide resident. The board encourage all these employees to reside in the district. That's it.
Yeah.
My point is, when I look at all district employees at the executive director level and above shall be bona fide residents, I mean, if you're going to request one, request all. And then let's go through all our schools and let's check our hardship transfers and see who lives.
We'll talk about this again in 2 weeks, but it's not like we're not getting anywhere. So we don't have the same conversation in 2 weeks.
Well,
and we're going to take a vote in 2 weeks.
So if you're, if we get to the point where you're allowing a waiver, then you need to, I would recommend keeping the final paragraph that talks about if the employee fails to move into the district within 12 months of the hearing signed. I think the waiver should be a waiver.
You say that you what?
An employee who fails to meet the residence requirement at the end of the 12-month period shall be reassigned. So the way this policy reads now is superintendent can provide a waiver, but if that person doesn't move into the district within 12 months, they're reassigned.
Right.
So my recommendation would be the superintendent require a waiver, then they shouldn't have a 12-month. They shouldn't have any waiver.
Right. But if they're not waived, then they should move in 12 months.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
If they're not waived, then
they're
not waived.
They can apply for a waiver that in theory applies for as long as, what you're thinking is, a waiver for as long as they're an employee, mm-hmm. with the caveat that Jack put out there, that a future board could obligate. Mm-hmm. But another thing would be that the superintendent could give them a 12-month waiver. If we don't give them a waiver, that the superintendent could say, hey, well, I'll bring this person in for 12 months. If they don't, and the board says, no, we're not going to give them a waiver. So then that person knows that within 12 months they have to live in the district or they'll be reassigned. Is that what I'm hearing? I'm just trying to understand it, but I've already said what I said.
I'll bring my version to the table.
Okay.
Trustees, if you have any versions, if you want them in, send it in early.
For the record, it's not as it is. The policy is for them.